and welcome to the beautiful city of Odense, Denmark's third largest city, and a city famed as the birthplace of the world-renowned poet and author of children's fairy tales, Hans Christian Andersen. It's also the host city for the Yonex Denmark Open, the ninth event on the 12 tournament MetLife BWF World Super Series. Not only the ninth event, but also the fourth of five premier events, an even higher tier of tournament within the Super Series. Plus, as you can see, we have the Super Series finals at the end of the year. And the destination, once again, is Dubai. Well, it is semi-finals day today here at the Yonex Denmark Open. Five matches for you this afternoon. And we're starting with men's singles. And Brice Lavades of France in his first ever Super Series tournament semi-final. He's up against the left-handed Tanhonsak Sengsun Bunsak, recent winner of his first Grand Prix gold title in home soil in Thailand. Then we've got women's doubles, and it's the World Championship bronze medalists against the Olympic bronze medalists, Meswari and Poli of Indonesia, up against the defending champions, Jung Kyung Eung and Shin Seng Chan. Then it's mixed doubles and the three-time former champions, Jochen Fischer-Nielsen and Christina Pedersen, up against the Cox, Chris and Gabby, the Commonwealth Games gold medalists. Women's singles will follow that, and Carolina Marin, the world and Olympic champion, looking for her first Super Series tournament final this year. She's up against the in-form Akane Yamaguchi, fresh from victory in the last of the Super Series events prior to this Denmark Open. That was in Korea. Then we finish with men's doubles and the 2016 Olympic silver medalists against the 2012 Olympic silver medalists. Govi and Tam Wee Kyong of Malaysia, up against the former winners here and home players Matthias Bo and Carsten Morgensen. Well, I was saying that the Super Series finals at the end of the year, well, it's only for the top eight players and pairs in each of the five disciplines. And this is the Super Series standings at the moment. As you can see, three Danish players, two Chinese players, two Hong Kong players. Seven of the top eight players have been in a Super Series tournament final this year. The only exception being the number six, Mark Schwebler. But the big mover after the Korean Open was Song Wan Ho. He reached the final of his home event and shot up to number three. Of course, the only player also on that top 10 list who's involved in semi-final stage here at the Denmark Open. Because when we look at the semi-finals lineup, well, he's in the bottom half of the draw against another Korean player, the former world number one, Lee Hyun Il. In fact, that's a repeat of the semi-final from the Korean Open. Only one seed left, and that is that man, Song Wan Ho, because in the top half of the draw, Brice Lavades, what a result for him yesterday, beating Lee Chong Wei of Malaysia, the two-time former champion here and current world number one, Lee Chong Wei, celebrating his birthday yesterday. 34 he was yesterday, but couldn't celebrate with a win. So we're going to concentrate on the top half of the draw, our first semi-final today. Well, I'm Jill Clark, sitting alongside Steen Pedersen, former head coach to the Danish national team, as we look at the lineup for our first match. Brice Lavades against Tanhonsak Sengsun Bunsak of Thailand. And Steen, we have to talk about Brice Lavades. That is the first time that a European has managed to beat the world number one, Lee Chong Wei, in 7 years, since Jan O. Jorgensen beat him in the first round of the China Open back in 2009. It was a superb victory, and here he is, the man of yesterday, Brice Lavades.
Yeah, fantastic result for the French player. What character he showed after missing two match points in the second game, coming back in the third and still managing to get that very, very surprising win against Lee Chong Wei.
Beat the world number one, Lee Chong Wei, in an amazing tough game yesterday. And Tanhonsak has been competing against the top players in the world for many years. They have faced each other twice before, with one win each.
Well, the MC, just giving the fans a little bit of background about both the players. But what an occasion for this man. This is his first ever Super Series semi-final appearances. He's been in a couple of quarterfinals previously. One of them was here at the Denmark Open. That was 2 years ago when he lost to Chen Long, who went on to win the title, and he'd beaten the seeded Hans Christian Vietinghus in the very first round 2 years ago. So that was the seed he put out then, the seed he's put out this year, Li Chongwei. I think that's really stunned the badminton world. It's the biggest upset, I think, in recent, well, I was going to say recent Super Series tournaments, probably all of the Super Series tournaments this year.
Yeah.
Well, there was a little bit of concern about Brice Lavadez yesterday during his quarterfinal match because he fell awkwardly, had to stretch out his leg afterwards. But yeah, has he got a bit of strapping on? Not terribly sure. I can't see properly. No, I don't think he has.
Oh, should be then on his ankle, perhaps.
30 years of age, currently 38 in the world ranking, went up one place this week, but he has been as high as 22, 2 weeks in November 2 years ago. This is his seventh appearance here at the Denmark Open, and apart from that quarterfinal 2 years ago, his other appearances have resulted in first round losses prior to this year. Well, when you look at his results so far, Zulfadli Zulkifli of Malaysia went the full distance in the first round, and then in the second round beat the number five seed Chao Tianchen in two straight games, and yesterday beating the two-time former champion, the world number one, in three thrilling games, an hour and 17 minutes. It really was the result of his career so far. So to the left-hander, well, Tanonsak Sensung Bunsak turned 26 9 days ago. And of course, he's on a great run at the moment. He's 18 in the world. He has been inside the top 10, as you can see. And that was for a couple of weeks, exactly 3 years ago, because 3 years ago, he was in the semi-final here and then backed it up with semi-final at the French Open the next week. And as far as the Thailand player is concerned, he won his last tournament, the Thailand Grand Prix Gold. So he's on a nine-match winning streak. Yesterday's quarterfinal was against the qualifier, Anders Antonsen, in three games, having beaten the previous date, the number four seed, and the player we saw as number one on the Super Series standings, Tian Haowei of China. So twice going the full distance, the left-hander in the first round and in yesterday's quarter-final. Jakob Sindberg of Denmark will be umpire for this one. It will be the third meeting between these two players, and of the previous two, as you can see, honours are shared. The last time they met was actually in the qualifying of this year's All England Championships. Two straight games it was to Brice Lavadez. 37 minutes that took. My goodness, what a difference between the first Super Series of the year and the ninth. Here they are in the semi-final, having both had to play the qualifying at the All England Championships. So our court officials for this one, always a big occasion for the court officials as well as for the players. Well, I should think both men must be pretty nervous. What an occasion, what an opportunity for both of them.
That's a good opportunity to reach Super Series final.
And on my left, Tanonsak Sonsong Bunsuk, Thailand. Please, Lavadez, to serve.
Big smile Love here from Lavadez. Looking forward to the match.
Well, before we really get into this, Stephen, we perhaps ought to just clarify the injury problem. We didn't see Brice Lovedes' match against Li Chongwei yesterday. I was reading a report a little earlier today which said that he had perhaps strained a muscle and was stretching out his leg. But I know you've been in the practice area earlier today and managing to speak to some of the coaches and players. It's an ankle injury, did you say?
I actually don't know the nature of the injury, but I saw it happen yesterday because I had a little glimpse on that court.
Okay.
And it seemed like it was something with his foot. I don't think he twisted it, but yeah, probably felt something odd in his foot. And whilst I was in the warm-up area, he was warming up quite well together with his coach.
2-1.
So let's hope that it's nothing serious.
Yeah, that would be cruel, wouldn't it, if when you're in your first Super Series semi-final,
yeah,
unable to perform to your maximum because of a little niggling injury. Be heartbreaking.
Yeah, and he hasn't really had a lot of time to enjoy the victory over Li Chongwei. Probably one of the best wins since Pi Hongyan was competing for France in women's singles. Played late last night and up and playing early here this Saturday. Lunchtime, is it?
Oh, broken strings already for Danon Sak. Did well to control it. Maybe it happened as he was playing this smash. So this is for the left-hander, his fourth Super Series semi-final. But first for very nearly 3 years. Yeah, we talked a little bit about that yesterday, didn't we, Steen, about, you know, we both thought that Sensun Bunsak was hugely talented. We thought he was making a breakthrough in 2013 with those Super Series semi-finals, and then he seemed to go into the wilderness a little bit.
Yeah, I don't know if he's had any injuries or what. It's always a puzzle. Anyway, Ponsana Bunsak sort of recaptured his spot as the number one Thai player and went to the Olympics. So in many ways, it's logical that Sensun Bunsak is playing well now, because he's had time to prepare for the post-Olympic era, so to speak. Of course, in great playing form after winning his home tournament.
Yes, that his first Grand Prix gold title.
Good shot there.
And his fourth final. And do you think that the attacking style, that sort of rally from Brice Lovedes, is the way he should be playing?
Yeah, I think he should try to control the match. Play mostly downwards, flat lifts, because we know that Sensun Bunsak is a strong attacking player.
Service over.
I have a strange feeling. Maybe Lovedes is a little bit nervous, but if that's not the case, then I'm interpreting it as he's just trying to see how much he can get out of this. So perhaps he's not entirely free of injury. Seems a little sort of taking it rally by rally.
4-7.
Yeah, he's certainly got good sporting pedigree, hasn't he? Because both his parents were involved with judo and his brother was an international judo player.
Oh.
Often runs in the family if you have parents or other family members that used to do well in sports.
Yeah.
Gets instilled in you when you're young. that fighting spirit.
Yeah, it's almost if he's not quite focused in, that his mind is concerned about the injury.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's a good return.
Five. Nine.
Cool, good.
Service over.
He's got many talents, Bruce Levadais. He's started his own company back in Paris, Levadais Paris, manufacturing or selling shirts, high-class shirts. And you're going to see one of his creations when the coach 11, comes on court five, because he's wearing it.
Well, it's a six-point advantage for Danon Saxin.
The story that I wanted to tell you, if I tell you, it's going to be in such coded language that it won't make any sense to you. So, but you'll get it at some point. But what I do want to tell you, and that's actually kind of serious. You remember what Anas told you about this guy?
Yeah.
Okay. You're playing like cross drops all the time, and he's just standing there waiting, and he's rolling, and he's actually like you're going to lose the net if we play those backhand side. That's all.
Just to move a bit faster.
Yeah. Get the legs going. Get legs going. And don't use that cut from the forehand side. Just play straight or stick.
Well, he's an interesting character, you were telling me, Steen, the 11, French coach. He's a Dane, Jesper Hogel.
Yeah, he is. He's actually a professional poker player. He's got two bracelets from the World Series in poker, which is the World Championships in poker. Also won one of the big online tournaments and making a living from poker. Now trying to start up a management company in badminton. They met each other as Bruce Levadais played team badminton for Greve in the Danish badminton league last year, where Hogård was manager.
Service over. Six. And 12.
Most people might have expected to see Peter Gerda on the coaching chair because he's the French national coach, but Brice Levadais is an independent player.
That's a good net shot.
Yeah.
Well, immediately looks towards his coach. Would that have gone wide, he says? I suspect it might have done. He doesn't only care about life after badminton. He's 14, very keen on protecting the environment, is Bruce Levadais. And I know that he plays the guitar, and he was telling me that if he hadn't have been a badminton player, he would have liked to have been an actor or a musician. And he's got lots of different interests. That's always healthy, I think, in an athlete.
15, 7.
Now, what was the coach saying about that cut across court?
Very nice. Yeah. So far, quite a one-sided match, but I think That's what we often see when you made a really good result the day before. It takes a game to sort of get back into it. And we also heard Spohoko say, get the legs loosened up and so on.
Service over. 8-16.
Yeah. He's been clinical, Senton Bonsak.
18-9. He's looking relaxed now, the left-hander. I thought the first couple of rallies he looked a little bit nervous, but he's definitely settled the quicker of the two.
Yeah. Probably feels now that he has a good chance of taking this match. Unless Livadis can up his game. Great net play by Senson Bonsuk. And of course, that's one of the things. If you are a strong attacking player, you've got to have strong net game as well, because you want to create, you want to be able to create the chances for yourself.
Yeah, converts on his first game point opportunity. Just 13 minutes for that opening game. 21-9 confirms the umpire. Match clock just ticked over to 14 minutes.
There is a silver lining. There is a silver lining. These shirts are really, really comfortable. Honestly, I could wear this all day. Yeah, it's gotta be normal. It's gotta be, no, it's not normal with shirts like this. It's like, I think the spiral shape of it just makes it, it's like, for a right-hander, it's...
That's the first time I've heard
like
a coaching session turned into a...
Maybe we should change. Maybe
an advancement.
Yeah, but my sponsor would do that. I hope, yeah. I need to get some rhythm.
Yeah.
I don't have any, like, length or pushes. And his rhythm is just, like, unusual.
It's a bit
like,
awkward, yeah. It looks awkward the way he's... So, when you lift to his, when you lift to his round the head side, he's going straight all the time.
Yeah, but then one time he did the cross court also.
But the time he goes cross court is when he has more time. Is if you lift higher. If you lift, if you lift low and flat, he always goes straight. And as soon as you start reading that, because you will now, then he'll start going to the body a little bit more.
The players are focusing on the cross.
He's hurting a little bit
from the round the head side of Tenosac.
Playing net with his backhand side is not what we want to do. Just you can do anything else. You can play inward. You can play in court. You can play it to the forehand side. You can do whatever you want. Just don't directly look to play it to the backhand court. That's all.
Court
tomorrow,
one,
when you win this match, court I want a new shirt for tomorrow. I do. Serious.
Well, he's obviously a character, isn't he, the coach?
To work on.
And knowing that he's a poker player, I think he's bluffing.
Isn't that great, though? I mean, obviously, he knows his player is uptight, and he's just said something to try and break the ice and just get him to relax.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's had the desired effect.
One, love.
What a super net shot, look at that.
And exactly as, not directly discussed, but that's the implication of it. Don't play net game in the backhand side of Sen Sombunsuk because he can play really tight there, which is actually quite extraordinary for a left-handed player who tends to be better at the forehand side of the net. We've discussed it earlier in this tournament. Sen Sombunsuk very strong. There it was again. Sets up the kill.
Yeah.
Yeah, one of the reads that Jesper Hogel, the coach, had was that Sen Sombunsuk is attacking from his backhand side, it's always straight. And then Levadeus replied, but once he played cross, like there, and the reply was, yeah, that's when he has really good time, when he can manage to get it cross. And that's exactly... Very, very good shot. That's exactly the good strategy. When you have enough time, wear your game, because then the players, they won't be able to pick up on when you only can hit it straight.
Yeah.
I guess the plan for Levadeus is to sort of keep it tight until he gets back in it. I think he's a little bit drained emotionally from the win against Lee Chongwei yesterday. So if he can play to a draw here and not lose anything, of course it's even better for him if he can get a lead, but mostly about not getting too much behind.
Just long. Yeah. It was just going through my head, though, prior to him going for that net kill. Three, he needs to take it earlier at the net.
Yes.
Because he was sort of letting the shuttle come to him and then playing up towards the net on the net shots instead of really trying to take it early.
Yeah. But I like that strategy there. Instead of not playing that corner, play it and then exploit that you know that Sen Sombunsuk is going to play back at you.
Yeah.
Service over. Five, three.
And the problem for Sen Sombunsuk is that he probably won the first game a little bit easier than he could have expected.
Yeah.
So.
Service over.
Can be difficult to find the right level in the second game. Can you expect that it goes just as easy, or are you actually, by thinking about that, letting your opponent into the game again? That's always a difficult thing.
Your point about Lovadeus being emotionally drained is very, very pertinent here, because I think that most people thought that after he'd had those match points in the second game and lost that second game to Lee Chongwei, that perhaps he was going to capitulate, and he showed great character in coming back to actually win, and that will have taken a huge amount out of him psychologically.
Yeah.
And probably going into yesterday's quarterfinals, he couldn't possibly have imagined in realistic terms that he would be playing again today.
No, no, no. He probably had to rebook his ticket.
Just overdone it.
Yeah.
7-5.
Oh.
Very good service from Sensen Boonsuk. Comes quite a bit into the court, so it's difficult for the Vadeis to spin it tight.
Five straight points to the left-hander. By the net court.
Nine, five.
Played by Ubadez.
Six, nine.
I think that flat backhand side, long backhand, flat backhand pushes and smashes to the backhand side of Sensen Boonsuk. That is, in many ways, the key for the Frenchman. It's not that he can't return a Sensen Boonsuk. Of course, he can do that, but it's mostly six. Straight. So he knows what area the returns are coming back to. I think he should put more pressure on that backhand side.
That's just 11, a gifted six, point, isn't it?
Interval.
Eight of the last 9 points going to Tanon Sak. Boonsuk.
He doesn't even know where he wants to put the shuttle in his. And then he's tricking me all the time, basically.
Yeah. So, aside from the fact that he's left-handed and awkward, what else can you do to set up your defense? Is it more disguise in the lifts? Is it a bit of base? I mean, there's got to be some sort of solution. Because right now, like the last 3 days, people you can just play and play and play, and nobody can get the ball down.
It's a bit like this guy is like not arming at all. He's just like going like this,
court
and then you don't know where it's going. So it's hard for me to anticipate.
One,
normally, the other guy they arm, so I can see.
I understand, but still try to think of the other factors that you can influence to set up the defense better.
Very interesting that Brice Levadez feels
11,
that he's got a little bit of an awkward style, Sensen Boonsuk, so he can't read his smashes. And we can see that his release is very quick, his swing, his whole arm, but it happens very, very quickly. A lot of other players, they have some sort of waiting time. And also, a relevant question from Jesper Haugorgen. If you feel your defense is not working well, what can you do to better it? Can you make a little disguise? Can you lift a little bit more flat and so on? Yeah. I mean, the read from the coaches, Kenneth Jonasson yesterday and Jesper Haugaard today, is, in my opinion, totally correct.
13,
when Sensen Boonsuk has time from his backhand side, he smashes cross.
Yeah.
When he's got no time, it's straight. So you can actually take big chances in the defense if you believe. And that's the key, to believe in the read.
But
I think more or less this game has drifted 14, away from Levadez. There's nothing left in the tank, and Sensen Boonsuk is playing extremely well. He's not making any mistakes, any free points. He's just grinding on.
Yeah, and now 11 of the last 12 points. 3-5 down. Yeah, that's good.
Steve,
you know, as you were talking then, it was occurring to me that I heard exactly the same as you. Levadez struggling to read what's happening. And many people will think, why. This is the third time that they've played against each other. He won the last time they played against each other in the qualifying of the All England Championships earlier this year.
Yeah.
You know, how is it that suddenly he can't read what's happening?
That's a really good question. I think, again, the playing conditions here benefits Sensenbrunsen more than Brisleva does. All England, that's a very, very big hole. There's room for an indoor athletics track and field course.
Yeah.
This is a very small hole, which favors the attacking players. So the timing of the smashes from Sensenbrunsen is probably better here. But I think there's a lot of psychology to it as well.
Yeah.
So, I mean, how can you beat Li Chongwei one night and then the next day you can barely score 11 points in a game against a player presumably not as good as Li Chongwei?
15.
Good shot.
I like that.
Yeah.
Very nice.
And look at the movement of his arm. It's 16, one movement altogether from he raises his racket until he finishes the smash. It's one sort of big flow movement. There's no breaks in it. There's not much to read on from Brisleva Days.
That's a good point, because I'm thinking about a player we'll watch later on, Catalina Marin, who takes the racket back very early, stops, and then hits.
Yeah.
Huge difference. That's a great spot. 17-9. A good lift from there.
Service over.
Yes, good rally.
There was the variation from Sensenbrunsen with a straight smash, even though he had a lot of time.
Yeah, from earlier on in that rally.
Earlier on.
Round 11, the position.
17.
Oh, that's good. Well, he tried that drive or push down the backhand side, but it was beautiful response from Sensenbrunsen. That was the one you had wanted him to try a little bit earlier, perhaps more on the straight than playing cross as he did then.
Yeah, but a great return from Sensenbrunsen. And just have to acknowledge that sometimes your opponent makes really, really good responses.
Yeah.
19.
three match point opportunities.
20 match point, 13.
Yeah. Well, slightly one-sided semi-final. And Brice Lovadays looked a little bit of a spent force today after his wonderful victory yesterday against the world number one. But take nothing away from Tanansak Sentsunbunsak. Tomorrow he will contest a first ever Super Series tournament final. He knows his opposition will be Korean, but will it be Son Man-ho or Lee Hyun-il? This is the final rally. Yeah, he played with composure. He did what was necessary. And he did have some nice variation there. Confirmation of the score. 21-9, 21-13 in 32 minutes.